Hi everyone, welcome back to my YouTube videos. In this video, I'm going to prove the two Borel-Cantelli lemmas. So the reason for that is the following. I remind you that in the previous three videos, we proved the implication that you see in this picture, like in yellow. So in particular, we know already that convergence almost surely implies convergence in probability. Also, convergence in any of the LP spaces implies convergence in probability, and convergence in probability implies convergence in distribution. Now, to complete the proof of this feature, the last step is to show that convergence in probability also implies convergence almost surely of a subsequence to the same limit. And for that, what we need to use to prove this implication is the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. So in this video, I'm going to prove this first lemma. And because the second one is a result that is interesting in itself and related to the first lemma, I'm just going to prove both lemmas in the same video. So those two lemmas were proved by mathematicians Emil Borel and Francesco Cantelli. And both results deal with what we call the limsup of a sequence of events. So before I state those results, I want to spend a little bit of time really giving you a very precise definition of what we mean by the limsup of a sequence of events, or in general, a sequence of sets. And you will see like the intuition behind this definition that we have to have in mind to be able to understand the proof. So let's assume that we have a sequence an of events, and let's look at the limsup of the sequence. So the limsup when n goes to infinity of an, again an are events, then by definition that's going to be the intersection over all n of the tail starting from n of the sequence of events. And so that's going to be intersection for n larger or equal to 0 of the union for k larger than n of the event ak. And so beyond this kind of set notation, you have some kind of intuition of what the limsup is. So let's assume that the limsup, so that's again an event. Let's assume that this event occurs. So what does it mean? Well, if you read this expression on the right-hand side and you just decompose this, you see that, so saying that the limsup occurs means exactly that for all n, there exists k larger than n, such that ak occurs. That means exactly that an occurs for infinitely many n. So that's the first thing we should have in mind before I state the result and before we prove those results, is the fact that the limsup of a sequence of events an is exactly equal to the event that an occurs for infinitely many n. So the first Borel-Cantelli lemma states that if the infinite sum of the p of an is finite, then the probability of the limsup of the an is equal to 0. So I rewrote the implication here, that's what we want to prove, and this is this result that we will need to prove that convergence in probability implies convergence almost surely for a subsequence. So let's try first to understand this statement. So the left-hand side is clear, the right-hand side again, if you have in mind that the limsup of the an is again the event that an occurs for infinitely many n, this means that if the sum here is finite, then only a finite number of those events is going to occur, okay? Or there is a probability zero that infinitely many of them occur, so with probability one, only a finite number of those events is going to occur. So to prove this, the proof is not very difficult. That's based on a basic application of the monotone convergence theorem. And so the idea is just to introduce a new random variable n. So n is some kind of random variable that is going to keep track of the number of those events n that are going to occur. And so n is just the infinite sum for n equals 0 to infinity of the indicator function of the event an. So you see that if you look at the expected value of this indicator function, that just gives you p of an. So it seems that the expected value of n should be equal to this infinite sum here. And so expected value of n is finite. Indeed, we can prove this. That's a consequence of the monotone convergence theorem. So more precisely, so let's look at the expected value of n. So expected value of n is by definition expected value of the infinite sum. And now the way you apply the monotone convergence theorem is really by thinking of the infinite sum as the limit of the partial sum. So I'm not going to write all the details, but you can replace this sum from 0 to infinity by a sum from 0 to m, let's say, and take in front here the limit when m goes to infinity. But then you see that because both functions, indicator function, are equal to either 0 or 1, depending on the value of omega, that means that the sequence of partial sum is non-decreasing. Okay, so because you can think of this infinite sum as the limit of partial sum which is non-decreasing, you can use the monotone convergence theorem to just extract, well, first the limit and then the partial sum, and then if you use linearly of the expected value, you again have that this is equal to the limit of the partial sum of expected value of indicator function of an. Okay, so if you do all this, so you can extract that, and eventually you get that this is equal to the infinite sum for n equal 0 to infinity of expected value of indicator function of an. Okay, so here I'm going to write the justification here. This is by monotone convergence, that we can say that, monotone convergence theorem. Then next step, well, expected value of indicator function of an, by definition, is the probability of an. So eventually you see that the expected value of n indeed is equal to this infinite sum. So that's equal to the infinite sum of p of an, but we know that this is finite by assumption, that's the assumption of the first lemma, and so what we deduce from this little calculation using the monotone convergence theorem is the fact that expected value of n is finite. And so why this statement is important? Well, expected value of n finite implies that n itself should be finite with probability 1. Okay, if n was, if there was a positive probability that n was infinite, then the expected value would be infinite. But here the expected value is finite, so the probability that n is infinite is equal to 0. But then the event that n is equal to infinity relates to this one, obviously, okay? We saw that, again, limsup of an is exactly equal to the event that an occurs for infinitely many n. And so, indeed, if you look at the definition of n here, saying that n is almost surely finite means that for almost all omega, okay, the number of an that are going to occur is finite, okay? So, eventually, conclusion, we can say from this, we deduce that p, the probability that n is equal to infinity, is equal to 0, but it turns out that those two probabilities, in fact, are equal, so probability that the limsup of an when n goes to infinity. Again, have in mind that this is the event that an occurs for infinitely many n, okay? If for some omega, the limsup of, if for, there is a little omega in this event, then that would mean that n of omega is equal to infinity, because omega is in infinity many of the an. So that means that infinity many of those indicator functions are equal to 1, and so n is infinite, okay? And so, because I'm using only if and only if, then eventually you get that the lim sup here of the an is indeed equal to the even that n is equal to infinity, okay? So this is equal to the probability of the even that n is equal to infinity, but we just saw that this event has probability 0. So indeed, this shows that if this infinite sum is finite, then this probability here is equal to 0. So that shows the first Borel-Cantelli lemma. Now the second Borel-Cantelli lemma basically states that the converse is also true if the events an are independent. So meaning that if the infinite sum of the p of an is equal to infinity and the events are independent, then the probability of the limsup, which is the probability that an occurs for infinity many n, this time is going to be equal to 1. So I rewrote the statement here, and to kind of understand the starting point of the proof, have in mind again that the limsup of the an can be expressed like using set notation in terms of infinite intersection of the over n of the union for all k larger than n than ak. I want to prove that just the probability of this infinite union of the tail of the sequence is equal to 1 to be able to conclude this. But to be able to use independence, I don't really want a union. I prefer to have an intersection, to use the fact that probability of an intersection is equal to the product of the probabilities. And so to turn this union into an intersection, I'm just going to take the complement and prove that the probability of the complement is equal to 0. That's kind of the spirit of the proof, like that's kind of the trick we need to use to prove this implication. So first, let's look at the probability of the intersection for all k larger than n of ak complement. Okay, this event is going to play a role after that mimics kind of the complement of this event here. So this, by definition, so here, maybe to insist on the fact that the sum is infinite, the intersection is infinite, I'm going to write it like this. We cannot say that the probability of this infinite intersection is equal to the product of the probabilities, even if those events indeed are independent, because by definition of independence, probability of intersection is equal to the product of the probabilities if you have a finite subset of those events. So to go from infinite to finite, the way we are going to deal with that is by using again the monotone convergence theorem. So I'm going to write this probability as the probability of the limit, let's say when m goes to infinity, of the intersection for k going from n to m of ak complement. Okay, that's just definition of infinite intersection. And now what I can do is just say that, well, as m increases, this is going to decrease because I'm taking an intersection over more sets. And so because this decreases, now I can use the monotone convergence theorem and extract the limit here, okay? So we can extract the limit using monotone convergence. So I'm going to just rewrite that this is just the same as the limit when m goes to infinity of the probability of this finite intersection now. Now, because the intersection is finite and because the event AK complement are independent, so I remind you also that if two events A and B are independent, then their complements also are independent. Then now I can replace the probability of this intersection by the product of the probabilities. So that tells me that this is equal to the limit when m goes to infinity of the product for k equals n to m of probability of ak complement, but probability of ak complement is just 1 minus probability of ak. So we have this product here, 1 minus probability of ak. Okay, now I'm going to use just a basic inequality in math in general. The fact that at least when x is between 0 and 1, let's say that's the case for this probability, 1 minus x is going to be less or equal than e to the minus x. So doing this, I obtain that this is, let's say, equal to, or less or equal, sorry, to the limit when m goes to infinity of a product for k equals n to m of e to the minus p of ak. Okay, then, now the good thing, by the reason why I'm using this exponential here, this inequality to have an exponential, is because we know that the product of exponential is equal to the exponential of the sum. And now, having the exponential of the sum, I can use the fact that the sum here is infinite. And so eventually, let me erase here what we deduce from that is that this probability here is less or equal than limit when m goes to infinity of the exponential minus the sum for k equals n to m of p of ak. Okay? Now, I want to reinject the limit inside. Now, I can do that by continuity of the exponential function. The exponential function is continuous, so I can just inject the limit here. But then that tells me that this quantity here is just equal to expected value of minus the infinite sum. But the infinite sum here is infinite. So exponential of minus infinity is equal to zero. And so eventually, all this reasoning implies that the probability of this event here is equal to zero. So I'm going to erase that. And now, again, exponential of minus this sum, because the sum is infinite, is zero. And so conclusion, this is equal to zero. So, now to conclude, from that indeed the limsup is equal to 1, I'm going to go back to the definition again of the limsup in terms of set notation. So, the limsup when n goes to infinity of an. So this is equal to the probability of the intersection for n larger than 0 of the union for k larger than n of ak. You see here that we have an intersection of, like, those events are exactly the complement of that. But because we have, again, here an intersection, but if you look at this as a sequence of n, when n increases, you look at a union over a smaller subset of smaller collection of events, and so you have monotonicity. So the intersection of this union is exactly the limit. You again have monotonicity, so this intersection can go outside the probability and become a limit. So I'm going to write that right now, like this, so that's again, we apply a third time the monotone convergence theorem. So this is equal to, we set the limit when n goes to infinity of the probability of this event. But then, we know that this event is exactly the complement of this one. So that means that the probability of this event should be equal to 1 minus this probability, so that's exactly 1. And when we take the limit, it doesn't matter, but eventually you have that those probabilities are all equal to 1, so in the limit, it's still equal to 1. So conclusion, indeed, if this infinite sum here is equal to infinity, and if we have independence, which is an assumption that we use to compute explicitly like this probability of intersection, then indeed the probability of the limsup of the AN here is equal to 1. So that indeed completes the proof of the second Borel-Cantelli lemma.